Hey, this is Kayo from EssentialDeveloper.com. Today we are going to analyze the Viper architecture, the what, why, and how, and decide if we can call it an architecture or a design pattern, like the MVC, MVVM, and MVP design patterns we talked about in the previous video. So let's go! So Viper was introduced in this blog post from 2014, and the main goals for the architecture were testability and to fix the massive view controller problem. Later on, a much more detailed article was released in one of the objc.io issues. You can find all of those links in the description. In the article, it's explained the motivations for using Viper. Again, testability, fixing the massive view controller issues, plus application design based on use cases, fitting well with platform frameworks like UIKit, and building features as independent modules. And we recommend you to read the article to learn more. So can we consider Viper a software architecture or just a design pattern? The Viper diagram defines a structure to follow, which seems like an architecture but may create a limited outlook of the application. Even though it's presented as an open architecture standard to solve the MVC limitations, where things can only be seen as models, views, or controllers, the Viper design pattern may have the same problems where the structure of the application only fits in its acronym definition, which, by the way, it's a pretty cool acronym. But if you read the author's definition of Viper, they say it's mainly divided into those types. The problem is that the acronym doesn't help sustain that, since many developers end up trying to follow the acronym template, like it happens in MVC, that should be used only for UI but ends up being used as an application architecture or software architecture. So in reality, the authors say that Viper can have less or even more layers of separation as needed, just like MVC does. And that's good, because you cannot have a template that solves all the problems. And the authors know that, but somehow this information was lost. So defining those layers of separation can define the overall architecture of the application, but Viper and the types defined in this name, like the view, interactor, presenter, entity, and routing, they sound more like an architectural design pattern that can solve the massive view controller problem and can make your code more testable, but it doesn't solve the software architecture problem. So Viper is trying to solve more a class dependency issue, like the massive view controller or testability, rather than module dependency issues. So Viper follows clean code principles, like the single responsibility principle, and it creates this template where we have clear separation of concerns. We have the view that is passive and just receives messages from the presenter and passes events back to the presenter. The interactor contains the business logic, as specified by a use case. For example, if it's an e-commerce app, a use case could be add this item to the shopping cart. Now, the presenter contains view logic, so it's going to get some response model from the interactor, convert it to some kind of view data, and pass it to the view, and react to user inputs coming from the view. So this is the MVP pattern here, as we showed it in the last video. And on top of that, it adds the interactor, entity, and routing, where the entity contains the application-agnostic model objects and routing that handles the navigation between screens. So Viper is pretty much the MVP design pattern plus some extra classes. Thus, to us, it's more of a design pattern than an architecture, because we may end up with clean code but spaghetti architecture. Yes, that is possible. For example, let's have a look at the to-do list sample project that they've shared along with this article. Okay, so I got their project from GitHub. You can find the link in the description. And I created an architecture diagram of the modules, the types, and how the dependencies are set up. So we have class dependencies and module dependencies in here. And as you can see, there are arrows going everywhere, and the arrows are crossing module boundaries. So dependencies are out of control, so changes to the software can break multiple modules, and of course, multiple tests as well. And we believe that software architecture is less about your class's responsibilities and more about how the components communicate to each other and how they depend on each other. What is coupled and why? What is decoupled and why? What is hard to change What is easy to change? How is the data flowing between layers? And why? Is the data going in one direction, two directions, multiple directions? Can we support the business short and long-term goals? So regardless if we are using or not using some sort of named architecture like Viper, our software is structured in many components that can be coupled or decoupled, that can be easy to change or hard to change. They can be developed and deployed independently or not. And the software structure, this software structure, these arrows crossing boundaries, those dependencies between classes and modules is the component's structure, and it is our software architecture. So let's zoom in here and have a look how Viper is defined in the sample project. So there is a common module where shared types live. For example, the core data stack and the core data representation of the model, the to-do item. And then we have a to-do item data structure independent of frameworks and some other modules. We have a root wireframe, and it depends on UIKit. So the common module, there is this center where every other module depends on, already depends on core data and UIKit frameworks. And as advised in the article, we separate our modules like features. So we have the list to-do module, where we list all the to-dos. That's the first screen of the app. As you can see, we have the app logic component inside the module, where we have our interactor that depends on the data manager. Data manager is a concrete type that communicates with the core data store to get to-do items from the database and converts it into the to-do item model. So the interactor depends on the models. Then it creates a response model. There is the upcoming item data structure. And it passes it to the output protocol that the presenter implements. And the presenter sends messages to the interactor through a protocol as well. And that's how the communication goes in and out the app logic component. As you can see, we have a return cycle here if you don't arrange those objects correctly with some kind of weak ref. And we have a video about weak refs. I'm going to add a link to it in the description as well. And the presenter also talks to the wireframe, and the wireframe also talks back to the presenter. So there's a two-way communication here, just like there's a two-way communication between the interactor and the presenter. Then the presenter talks to the view through an interface, and the UI view controller subclass implements that interface, and it talks back to the presenter through the module interface. So another retain cycle here if you're not careful. And the wireframe creates view controllers. This arrow was not defined in the Viper diagram, but that's how it goes in the example project. So the wireframe depends on UIKit as well. And since the presenter depends on the concrete wireframe, it also depends on UIKit. So even though the goal is to create this independent module, it depends on core data, it depends on UIKit, it depends on the shared common module, and it also depends on the add to-do module. That is a module responsible for creating to-dos. They also have their own app logic component, their module interface. They also have the same retain cycle problems here. So the whole thing depends on UIKit, and the whole thing depends on core data. Which means I cannot build this project without core data. I cannot deploy this code without core data or UIKit. I cannot just get this app logic component and move it to a separate module with no dependencies, which is a red flag for a clean architecture. So if you forget about the classes dependencies and just look at the module dependencies, it would pretty much look like this. So the common module depends on UIKit and core data. The add to do module depends on the common module, so it also depends on UIKit and core data. And the list to do module depends on both the common module and the add to do module, so it depends on everything. So changes to the common module might break the add to do and the list to do module. Changes to the add to do module might break the list to do module. And so it goes. So this is a tiny application, and we already might have some dependency problems. So as this grows, these spaghetti arrows going everywhere will become a problem. And for us, this is architecture. Architecture for us is this dependency management between not just classes, but between modules. Because the software product is the combination of all the modules, all the components together. And if things are too coupled, they might be hard to change. Even though it's easy to test the classes, by changing an unrelated module, you might break other modules. Not just break the modules, but the module tests as well. And that's why people hate testing. because they say it's a waste of time. And if your architecture doesn't allow you to change things without breaking the tests, yes, it is a waste of time, but you don't need to have this trade-off with testing. You can have quality or stability and speed at the same time with a good architecture. So Viper was defined as an iOS implementation of the Clean architecture by Uncle Bob. So here it is, Uncle Bob's Clean architecture. And it looks like, at least by the names, that it is very similar. For example, we have the entities in the center, we have the use cases, then the presenters and gateways. Then we have the outer ring where the deliver mechanism lives, for example, the UI, databases, and web. And the arrows always point inwards, which means the entities don't depend on the use case. The use case depends on the entities. And the controllers, or presenters, or gateways, they depend on the use cases. They never depend on entities directly. So the rings only depend on the closest inside ring. And at the center, at the core of the application, it should be the business rules. Then we have application business rules, or the use cases. And outside that layer, we have the presenters and controllers, or the adapters. And at the outmost ring, we will have frameworks and drivers, for example, core data, UI kit, buttons and views, all of that. And I'm going to add this article's link to the description as well, and I recommend you read it, because they also define that those are not all the rings. You can add more rings as needed. The only thing you should respect is that at the core, you should have your entities and your use cases, and everything else goes around it to serve the business rules, instead of the business rules serving databases, or user interfaces, or network connections. And there are other examples of architectures here, like the ports and adapters, the onion architecture, and etc. And the side effects, or the good side effects of those architectures are, they're independent of frameworks. They are testable. They are independent of the user interface, of the database. But that's not what Viper does, as described in the example app. Because if you go back now and arrange this architecture into layers, like the clean architecture, this is what we might end up with. At the core, we have our common module, where all the other modules depend on. And that module has core data and UI kits in there. In the clean architecture, it's advised for databases and platform frameworks to be in the out layer, outside, serving the features. But that's not what happens here. And we can fix that, but we require a lot of changes to the overall architecture. And that's another reason why we don't call Viper an architecture, but a design pattern for organizing our features and fixing the massive view controller. So our code bases are like living organisms, and they are changing all the time. So does the architecture. It is constantly changing, and it can be moving in a positive or negative direction. So modularity, for example, is a good architecture trait. If we don't have modularity in our system, it doesn't mean we don't have an architecture. However, we might quickly find out that the lack of modularity prevents us from moving fast and prevents us from achieving key business metrics. For example, deployment frequency, estimation accuracy, welcoming requirement changes, mean time to recover. At Essential Developer, our main drives are empathy, integrity, and economics. And business metrics are part of economics. So when we make decisions such as the system architecture, we must care about economics. And we do believe software architecture has a strong correlation with product success, product longevity, and product sustainability. So is Viper an architecture? Well, it depends on your interpretation of architecture. In ours, no, it's not. It's like an architectural design pattern, and it's a good one. If you do it with care, you won't have this dependency spaghetti or this spaghetti architecture. MVC, MVVM, MVP, and Viper, they are good design patterns. Use it with care, and don't forget about the economics of your decisions. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed and learned something today. Don't forget to subscribe, and I see you next time.